me and others, they wanted educational reform. That might sound weird, but we have a bunch of looking games after your educational reform. So there was a Frenchman named Thierry Coubertin. And one of the big reasons he wanted educational reform is because they lost the war. And I'm like, well, that's weird. But he felt that the men there, the teacher, being going to school, they were learning how to be leaders, and that's why they lost the war. And that if they wanted to remain a strong country, a strong empire, we have to make stronger, smarter leaders. Now, it's very sexist. This is all about men at the time. And even here in the later years, finally started to come around about allowing women into the buildings. But what he wanted to do was a couple of things. One, yes, his French country, international, so he wanted to make them smarter, better leaders. And he thought sport could help with that. And he traveled all around the world. You heard Professor Mann talk about rugby. The man who created rugby was all about educational reform also. It wasn't just the sport of rugby. That was there. That was just to help these men become all around men, sound bodies, sound minds, strong people, strong leaders. And he thought engagement with rugby would make them strong. So Coubertin traveled around the world, talked to people around the world, tried to put together his educational reform. Aside from sports, he wanted debate. He wanted a school newspaper. He wanted to make really smart leaders. And he thought, you know what? Sports can do this. But sports can also, besides winning awards, it can heal. And he wanted people around the world, particularly kids, he wanted young kids to see that other countries can get along. And, you know, this is before, obviously, the internet, television, and radio. So maybe the upper class, the little well-educated, could read about it, but the rest couldn't, they couldn't understand it. So it was really important to him to start these Olympic Games to promote peace and love around the world and to teach kids there's a brighter future. That's really what he wanted to do. So he didn't start it until the late 1800s, 1896. Again, you know, they took a couple thousand years off from Greece, and then he started to develop. England, what they call the Red Rock Olympic Society, they used to have Olympic Games just in England. And so he learned from them, he said, well, maybe I should take these Olympic Games back worldwide again. And this is General Coubertin, who is credited, rightly so, for bringing the modern Olympics back. So we're going to get to later about the business of the Olympics. It's now worth billions. The Olympic Games almost went bankrupt. They were losing a lot of money. It seems hard to believe now. But remember, they didn't have any of the revenue streams, like TV broadcasting and giant sponsorships and all that kind of thing back then. So how were they going to make money? Also, he really didn't want it to be too commercial. He turned down a lot of opportunities for businesses and said, no, you know, I want the games to be pure. This should be something that leads more to the destiny that I want these games to be. And that's to some of that. And that's why we have the good, the bad, and the ugly. Because there is that. There is that moment. Like, how many of you watch the Olympics a little bit when it comes in? And how many of you are really rooting for USA, for USA? And it could be for curling, right? A sport you never played, you never knew about, but oh man, those Americans better win. And feeling that sense of pride and giving that sense of pride to others is part of what he wanted people to understand. And the other thing that is the same way. Hey, you know, maybe we're not so different after all, and sports teaches us that. Right? We all know how hard the teams are playing, we want to beat them, and they want to beat us. So, the rings. Anybody know what the rings mean? The Olympic rings? You guys have seen them. Anybody know what they're about? So, there's five of them, right? The five are from the different parts of the world at the time when the Olympics came out. So, all the different areas of the world. And you see they're interlocked, meaning basically now and almost after the start in Switzerland. Does anybody know why Switzerland? He's not from Switzerland, he's a Frenchman. Switzerland, because you might study the history of Switzerland. Switzerland always remains neutral. They're that neutral site, they never engage in war. They won't take a side, no matter what. And he said, what better place to have the Olympics for their mission again, right? To teach that peace and love. So it's been there and it remains there. The Olympic Museum is there. So before I move on, I just want to learn the history of the ancient Olympics. The ancient Olympics were very different. And it started by accident. What happened was in Olympia, that's why they named the Olympics in Greece, it was a religious ceremony to honor Zeus. King of the gods, you probably saw Zeus like the big lightning bolt, big major god. So the people who put this together, they did it every 4 years to honor the harvest. So there's a special harvest every 4 years. And they would have this giant religious ceremony. The religious ceremony is probably nothing like you have at Mount St. Mary's or we have at Mount St. Vincent. They were pagans. Have you ever studied pagans in idolatry where they honor multiple gods? Have you studied that in all the years? These were some wild partiers, guys. And the Olympic fest that honored Zeus was a major party that went on. And think of the worst party you've ever been to, the craziest party you've ever been to, times 10. That's what went on here. Because that's what the religion provided. That's what was expected to have this let loose period of time. And out of this, just by accident, like I said, the Olympics began to form. Because the people were putting this together over 4 years. They kept trying to get people to come back and get more and more people to come. And what they noticed was they had it just for fun. They just had this race, just a running race. And they saw the excitement, the energy that came out of this, and how people were rooting for it. Because remember, too, guys, again, no TV, right? No newspaper, no radio. So your world is what's in front of you. You don't know the rest of the world. You don't hear about it. So when you see the fastest runner, to you, that's the fastest runner in the world. And that's amazing. And the Olympic people, even though it's a religious festival, they were kind of like businessmen. They caught on and they said, hey, we can get more people to come in. Maybe we should add some more sports. And they did, and they got more and more popular, and they added more and more sports. And then they made these sports heroes into gods. Sound familiar? We look at our sports heroes today. Like, any Giants fans? Anybody like Odell Beckham? He's in that godlike stature. And somebody with a PhD, you have no idea their name, right? They did that then. They pushed up these athletes. And there's a misnomer, there's a misunderstanding that these Olympic athletes were always amateurs. Not really true. Partially true. They didn't get paid money to be in the Olympics, but if they won, they got jobs for life, free meals for life, they were honored in their society, and they also competed in other games where they got paid, and they had agents. That's right, there were sports agents during the time of the Olympics. If you ever saw the movie Gladiator with Russell Crowe, you see the people carrying around the slaves there? They were the agents. And they would be hawking their athletes and getting them paid to get into different contests. And if you won the Olympics, they wanted you for all these different games that went on. So we in Heartline are going to come back to the idea that the Olympians should be amateurs. And that is what Cooper Tambaugh did. But even he kind of made some room for it. Really wasn't as fully amateur as you think it ever really was. So we have the International Olympic Committee based in Switzerland, and they decide what city gets to host the Olympics. So we're going to come back to that, because that's a really big deal. And there's a lot of questions about that. Originally, in the old times, it was held in like the Greece every 4 years, no question. The Cooper Tam, the man who started the modern day Olympics, he had his first ones in Athens, Greece, in 1896. And he did it to honor the Greeks and their best traditions. But he felt, like I was saying, he wants it all around the world because he wanted everyone to get a chance to see these games. Because again, no TV, no radio, you won't feel it as much unless you're a part of it. I can't feel that Olympic spirit. So he wanted the games to move. There was a lot of pressure on him to keep them in Greece. His own Olympic committee tried to tell him to do this, some of them, as did the King of Greece. And Greece was so angry they wouldn't do it, they tried to create their own games of Olympics, and they failed it. So oxymoron. There are confederations that cover the various continents. So, after you're a soccer fan, and you've heard of FIFA, right? So FIFA runs all the soccer. They're an international federation for soccer. Technically, they're under the IOC because they're a federation that supports the Olympics, and they help get the athletes who are part of that. So every sport around the world has different federations, and then every country has their own organizing committee. Here we have the USOC, and then you can see here all the individual sports, right? Yeah. Wrestling, skating, boxing, tennis. They all have different things they put in together to make the Olympics work, and this happens all around the world. I'm not going to go through these videos, but the bid process to have a city win. So you guys are from New York, a lot of you, right? To let you know, we bid to have the Olympics here in New York in 2012. If we would have won, those subways that you see now that are just getting extended, they would have been done by 2012. Every single borough of New York would have benefited from having the Olympics here. And what would be my benefit? Well, in Queens, we would have had a state of the art kayak center. We would have had a football stadium down in Manhattan that would have hosted the Giants and Jets, both, that had a stadium that could roll out from 30,000 to 100,000 on the covered building. All that would have happened if we won the bid. And the reason we didn't get the bid is because of one person who you might have heard of, who owns Madison Square Garden, James Dolan. And it was a business deal. James Dolan, who owns Madison Square Garden, the world's most famous arena, didn't like the idea that this amazing structure was going to be down in Battery Park, right? Because they could get some of the contracts now. They could be the big deal. So he played a lot of politics, and he got politicians here in New York to say, hey, we don't want the Olympics. And he went on the radio, got people on the radio and talked against it, that there would be a lot of trouble with parking and all these other things. And that's the only reason we didn't get it. And the world wanted us to have it. Because when we bid, when you bid as a city, you bid 7 to 8 years ahead of time. And this was just after 9/11. And so the world felt bad for us and wanted to help us get back on our feet. And they wanted us to have it. So what blew it? Madison Square Garden. So I love the Knicks, but I don't love Mr. Dolan for not giving us the Olympics. And these kinds of things, there's a lot of stuff that goes into a bidding city. And we'll be the finance of it. So it's society, right? That's what we're all about here today. I want to talk to you guys a little bit about the Olympic Spirit. Anybody ever hear that before? The Olympic Spirit, kind of heard about it, kind of, you know what it means? So the Olympic Spirit is all the good stuff that the Cooper Dam is talking about. So that great feeling you get because sport gave you something that made you feel special, that you identified with, something more, something good, something right. All the positive things that sport can bring is kind of what the Olympic Spirit is all about. I'm a huge boxing fan, and in Korea, this is a number of years back now, 1988 Seoul, Korea, not the last Olympics, there was a lot of stuff going on there with the officials who maybe weren't calling the fights right. And they happened to be Korean, and they happened to have Korean players win all these fights, where if you watch the fight, how did that happen? So as an example of the Olympic Spirit, it's kind of hard to see here. The man who's got the gold medal, he's actually raising the hand in the American who's got the bronze. And so he's standing up to his own country and said, hey, guys, you made the wrong decision here. You know he won, and I'm honoring him. Because he's such a good athlete, right? Like, I know that he is a father, he is a coach. I'm so proud when an athlete does the right thing. And this is an athlete doing the right thing. He's saying, look, I didn't fairly win. And I'm showing the world this. Pretty amazing. That's part of the Olympic Spirit. You guys might look too young. You ever know pretty cool runnings? So, a Jamaican bobsled team. Kind of weird, right? Like, you get Jamaican, find out the first thing in your head is it's getting a bobsled. So, the fact that this ragtag group of guys got together with an English coach to help them along, and they actually competed fairly well. So, they literally went in like wooden crates and went down like a wooden fake bobsled trail to start training. And actually competed fairly well. They looked all around the world, people were rooting for this team because they're the underdogs. They're this group that just wants to compete, that just tries, and top rated figure skater, really pretty, all American girl. And then there's Tanya Harding. She was kind of a blue collar girl and good skater, very athletic, but didn't have the kind of backing that Kerry had. So her husband, a man named Kevin Lulley, inspired a couple other men to literally take out Nancy Kerry. At first, they were going to kill her. That was the first hope. They were going to kill this girl so that Tanya Harding, in this case, instead of Nancy Kerry. Cooler heads prevailed. They said, instead, we'll just break her kneecaps. And they came out during the trials of the U.S. Figure Skating Championship and knocked the knee out and broke her leg. Damaged her knee. This top flight skater. So they do eventually let Tanya Harding stay on the team. Nancy Kerrigan, later on, starts to heal up. They let her come back. And when she goes to the Olympics and gets the silver medal, people will cheer for her like she got the gold. So again, you kind of see the Olympic spirit is not so much Jeff Lulley and his band of athletes and somebody out, but this woman perseveres and moves on. And then she keeps going, she keeps fighting. And she's in a lot of things. We can't do a woman's silver medal. The 2004 Rapid Soccer team, while we were at 4A, you know, we think of here, you know, here are our enemies. But we got to see what this unit is. We got to see what just a bunch of young kids like we might see with you, who just want to play soccer. Who's adults there, or older people, involved in sport, hey, just athletes who want to play soccer. It humanized the Iraqi people for a lot of the world. And a lot of them even stayed in U.S. households. So here, guys, all the things I'm talking about is the good for the Olympics. Sometimes you're too good for your own good. So there was a cross-country skier, and they never said cross-country, right? You know, so she breaks one of her poles. And a coach for another team offers her one of his. He had an extra one he gave it to her. She ends up beating his team and getting the medal. So they would have the medal. They didn't offer her that stick. But still, we have some research. Probably the best example by far of the Olympic spirit to me is the paralympic. This is all for the disabled athletes. Some of you might have heard of Special Olympics, right? For the development of the disabled, which is wonderful. I'm also akin to this. But the paralympics really started with one man who decided that disabled people should do athletic endeavors. And it changed the world for disabled people. And I'm not minimalizing, this is true. It truly changed the world of how we look at disabled people, how they felt about themselves. The disabled were shunned, and still are sadly in some countries, but completely shunned out, not part of society, looked down upon, looked on as parents' mistakes. And this doctor originally worked with military people when he got injured, but then started working with those from birth. And the old thing that was told to everyone is, hey, don't make a disabled person do any exercise. It'll be worse for them, it'll hurt them, it'll be bad for their bodies. And nothing could be further from the truth. And this doctor showed that, proved it, and changed the way it works. I worked with Mets for a number of years, and the best thing I did while I was there is we helped establish a wheelchair softball team. And you saw how great they felt playing, how wonderful they felt when their kids are watching them, and they're their sports heroes, at least for that day, and what that can mean. So if we really want to learn the Olympic spirit of Grand Paralympics, probably do it more than anything else that we're going to see. And we have been a contractual agreement between the International Olympic Committee and the Paralympics on them, support them, keep that going through. So the Olympics have always been politicized. Always. And when I say politicized, it means that countries are looking to use the Olympics for their own political gain. Steroids happen because of the Olympics. Steroids came up, and this one is really interesting here, is the 1936 Olympics in Berlin, in Germany. This was when Hitler was in power. And the world had heard rumblings. They weren't done. And Germany bids on the Olympics, and most of the International Olympic Committee are saying, well, you know, we really don't want Germany to win the Olympic Games. We don't want to give it to them because these things were here. Interestingly, Pierre de Coubertin, the man who won peace around the world, said, I want the Germans to have these games. Doesn't that seem weird? Doesn't that seem kind of completely opposite of everything he was talking about? Anybody tell me why you think that? Why did he want Hitler to have these games if he's all for peace and love around the world? Yeah. Well, you're getting really close to it. Really good. The idea, and nice start. The idea was that, you know what, if they're doing bad things, so let's expose this. And maybe they won't do as much, because the Olympics will make them think twice about the message of what they should be in the world. That was the Coubertin's thought process. He might debate that and say, well, that's not really smart. However you feel. But that was his mindset. And one American embarrassed the Germans. So Hitler wanted to show his Aryan race was going to be the dominant race, the big world leaders. And he wanted his Olympians to win. He wanted them to win so bad that he had a couple of his guys pretend to be women so they could win some medals in the Olympics. In order to get the Olympics, he had to promise that there would be Jewish Germans competing in the Olympics. So he allowed one woman who was half Aryan, half Jewish, to enter. And then they had a Jewish woman who was amazing, breaking all kinds of world records in track and field. They said, all right, we're on the team. Then cut to 3 days before the Olympics begins. So it didn't quite work out. During the Olympics, one American, like I said, changed Hitler around. And that was Jesse Owens. Jesse Owens went to Ohio State University, the Ohio State University, for those of you who are here, and dominated the track. Completely dominated, showed the world, hey, all these Aryans aren't real. Interestingly, really interestingly, the top German athletes befriended Jesse Owens to his own peril. This gentleman knew what was going to happen. He went and shook hands in front of Jesse, became good friends with him, and the German war machine, the Nazis in charge there, didn't like this. It was a bad PR move to be seen being friendly with the American who had just defeated him. Now, this guy could have had it really easy. They were going to put him in this real cushy job in the military when he was done. No worries. Instead, because he made this stance, the Germans put him on the front line knowing there's a very good chance he'd get killed, and he did. And Jesse Owens talked to him to his death about the strongest line I've ever seen, the most honest to his core credentials, and it really made the world think of it, too. Sadly for the Americans, we had cut the number of our Jewish players, and they weren't allowed to race. And the worst, we're not so perfect either. It's how we treated Jesse Owens when he came home. So he changes everything, right? He shows the world that, hey, the Germans, we can take them. When he comes home, he's shown the back entrance from the president's receiving. All the way back, let's go from the front. He went through the back. So, kind of interesting to see the times and what they meant and how the Olympics is next. How many of you guys have seen this picture of Power Sloop? Black Power Sloop, it's one of the most iconic pictures in sports. This was in the late 1960s, in 1968 in Mexico City, and they call it the Sloop. Everyone knows it from this, who knows it better. And what it was two African-Americans fighting for civil rights. Kind of like the anthem stuff you see now. It wasn't as connected to police brutality at all. It was actual civil rights. Laws that say, hey, we're equal in every way, not separate water fountains, not separate education. And there's a really big movement in it. And you guys are going to see that if you stick around for the activism now. This is the things we're talking about. And this was really tense. Really tense times. The track and field coach begged these guys, please don't do this. We're about the United Americans. We don't want you to do that. But they felt compelled. Now, I got a question for you. Look at this picture here. Why are they both wearing the same glove on the same hand? One's got a right hand, one's got a left hand. Anybody think they know the answer to that? Why not two guys with the right hand and two guys with the left hand doing the salute? things that the Yucatan wanted, about peace and love around the world, people were taking advantage of their own political game in different cases, like we saw in Germany, and then they're trying to propose this area, like we see here. And I'm not saying right or wrong, you know, that's a whole different question. But it is politicized. The one white guy sitting there was a South African who actually supported these two black guys and wore this big pin supporting civil rights. So okay, very interesting to see how powerful so over the years. Boycotts. To this day, my dad's flying. My dad was in promotions, and he had the rights of that little Russian bear here in the U.S. for Moscow in the 1980 Olympics. Only problem was, we the Americans, we pulled out of the Olympics that year because of politics. So we didn't end it. Why? Because the war went on with the Russians in Afghanistan. And President Carter, Jimmy Carter, who was president at the time, warned the Russians, said, hey, if we don't pull out of Afghanistan, we're pulling our athletes out of the Olympics. And you might say, well, who cares if you're Russian? Well, Russia's hosting it, and we're the big rival. We're the ones they want to beat. Without us there, it's not a big deal. But they beat everyone else there. Okay. So we pull out, and we really hurt their games. So what do you think happened in 1984 in the U.S.? Russia said, oh, really? Here we don't come. So the Russians don't come to our Olympics. Right after this, the International Olympic Committee said, hey, this is going way too far. And they negotiated a deal basically saying that the Russians and Americans agree never to do this again. And it hasn't happened since. Like I said, steroids it's happened because of the Olympics. All that juice that some people might be using, hopefully not. All happened because the Russians and the Americans had the Cold War. You guys have heard about the Cold War, right? So thank God it never escalated into actual bombs going back and forth. It came really close. But Russia wanted to show their people, not so much the world, but show their people that we are a strong, powerful nation, and that our system, this communist system, is the best. And they wanted to show it through the Olympics. So if we're great at sport and we dominated the world, that shows how powerful we Russians are. And the Americans are like, oh, really? We can play that game too. So early on, the Americans are really doing much better than the Russians in many of the sports, including weightlifting. All of a sudden, the Russians start beating us. And okay, all right, maybe one more game, maybe we've got to train a little harder. Then another game, and we're losing again. We're like, well, what's going on here? And the rumor is, I can't prove this, but the rumor supposedly would happen was one of the Russian coaches was out late one night and had a few too many drinks and was kind of bragging about these new chemicals and drugs that they use for their athletes, and an American coach overheard it. So, if you were the American coach, what do you think you did right away? Ratted him out. Said, oh, you shouldn't be doing this. That might have been the right thing to do. But what did he do? We gotta make bigger, better drugs. So just like getting more and more bombs, the Russians and Americans get all better and better steroids, or stronger and stronger steroids. So this whole thing, everything that came of this, was just a show off in the Olympics. That's all it was.
You can see, Vasily Kolesnikov, the man in the world, he doesn't have an impressive body of body, but he was the strongest man in the world at one point. You might have seen, have you ever seen Rocky IV? Drago, so the old Russian thing with the steroids. Ironically, Stallone was using steroids for Rocky IV, but that's what it is. Now, what really freaked people out was not the men using steroids, but they found out that women did. And there was a series of Olympics in the 1976 to the 1980s, where we at home were just shocked and awed. You're not shocked at all now to see a really muscular, strong woman. That doesn't surprise you. You see Serena Williams, hey, that's a strong lady. In that time, that was weird, that was odd, that was freakish, right? The term freakish meaning out of the norm. And these East German women had very manly attributes. And the world was like, what is going on here? And they're just destroying records. They're not beating records, they're destroying records that have been around 30, 40 years. Dumb. These women are just crushing. And as it turns out, their coaches are making sure that each of them are using really high dosage. steroids and other types of performance-enhancing drugs, not knowing what would happen to these poor women after using them. Years later, there's been a few documentaries showing one woman in particular had to have sex change because of all the drugs that were in, she now felt much more a man than a woman. Others had terrible physical and mental challenges as they moved forward, because it was just, imagine like rats in a lab, guys. It was no better than that. There was no control, there was no real talk to, hey, what's going to happen to these poor women? It was all about, we must win and take more. And that was it. So the world got to react to this, and in a really strong way, which led to the first group to really test for these types of drugs, WADA, or the World Anti-Doping Agency. So WADA has established to say, hey, you know, no more of this stuff. We've got to cut this out. Have they been really successful? No. Hire a Russian team was thrown out of the prior Olympics, and just recently. But they started to make headway. They started to make athletes at least think twice, because what was difficult about this, it wasn't a personal choice. It wasn't you saying, all right, I'm doing this for me, I'm going to shoot some steroids and do better. This is your government telling you, you have to do this if you want to be part of this team. If you have any pride in your nation, you're going to do these drugs. You're going to do these things. So they didn't have any choice. And they were in a communist society where it made it even more difficult to have other choice or to have more freedom. The chance to be an athlete was a really step up and would establish your life's opportunity with maybe not great wealth, but definitely security. So they were afraid to say what they were doing.
Miracle. Miracle for the U.S.
The 1980 U.S. hockey team. Some of you might have seen the movie, or heard a couple TV shows about it too. So here's the crux of it, guys. Did you? All right, so you know the whole deal, right? So I won't bore you with it all over again. But I want to ask you this. Did you get into how the Russians dealt with this? What it meant to them? As much as it was our rise, we also see the beginnings of their decline. Right, so we these kind of crazy college kids come and beat our all-star team that are in the Army for hockey. And it devastated. It caused a lot of change. Now, not alone, there were a lot of other things at play at the same time. The Russians were overspending for the economy that we had. They couldn't keep building up the military and escalating the way we could. They didn't have enough capital because of their system. Communism didn't allow capitalism. They couldn't make as much money. They couldn't keep up in this arms race. And then losing that made them lose face. Remember I told you about the whole thing for steroids so they could be a big, strong group? How do you think they felt losing like this? It's like having our dream team lose to a bunch of college kids from Russia or from England or from wherever. Can you imagine LeBron's face if he lost to a bunch of college kids? What that would say to us about our NBA? That just can't happen, and it happens. So it was the beginning of the demise. But it was great for Americans. They didn't feel proud. I remember literally, I was in the hospital with double pneumonia when this was going on. I jumped out of bed, I went nuts, clapped the crazy nurses, came running in like before I was dying. I'm like, oh, they won! Everyone went nuts with this one. This changed everything. We started feeling good again. So the politics go both ways. So I want you to make me think from the Russian point of view, it really is. Have you heard about the terrorism that happened in the Olympics?
kidnappers killed all these Africans. And we all want you to do it to make up their political message across. Right? So when you see a terrorist attack, when you see why they look publicly, well, they use the old instruments. And since then, security obviously has been beefed up, and there's been a lot more about it. But this was a truly tragic event that the whole world was watching. So for this group, they got their point across, whatever it is they wanted to show. There was a bombing in 1996 at the Atlanta Games, and we weren't nervous about it. Which sounds weird, right? You weren't going to bomb anywhere. Like right now, you guys heard about those bombs in the mail that are going around, like, you know, about one and the other. What's the first thing you want? Terrorism, right? In 1996, remember, this is pre-9/11, we never thought of that. We thought, oh, this had to be a work of some lunatic, just some guy. And they got the wrong guy. They wanted to solve the crime so fast that they just picked someone up. And this poor security guard who was there, saying it's him, and he didn't do it. And he had a terrible life there. Years later, after that, they found out who it was, and even after they found out who it was, people still thought it was him. And so it was a really kind of odd thing that it happened. So, now we're doing on time. Okay, we got a couple minutes. Just to show you the business of the Olympic Games. When you bid as a city, did you guys go through this at all about revenue streams in the Olympics? And how you get money and how you don't? So one thing you may not know is the cities don't make, they make but a tiny percentage of the money that comes in for the Olympic Games. 92% of the money that comes in goes to the International Olympic Committee that they divvy back out to all the other groups. They're a non-for-profit, right? So when you hear non-for-profit, and Dr. Fung was talking about that earlier this year at the NCAA, the money you get in, you've got to redisperse. But the cities that bid, right, they're spending billions of dollars. They're not getting most of this money, so the TV money. Let me give you an example. Here in the United States alone, the TV rights for the Olympics, just to show here in the U.S., was $2 million that NBC made. The city gets a tiny percentage of that. So it's really hard to make money as an Olympic city. So why else would you do it? Well, there's a couple of reasons. In China, they just wanted to show the world that we're changing, we're evolving, you should do business with us, and you should come here. Russia, they wanted to show their might again, and they got the Olympics twice. You also, yes, you want to develop tourism, not just for the immediate impact. So cities get immediate revenue impacts. The marathon coming next week is going to bring New York City and state over $500 million. From all the runners coming around the world to race, country, they got to stay in hotels, they go to restaurants, they shop. That brings in over $500 million. U.S. Open tennis, same thing. So the Olympics can provide that. So you can get some nice money, but you're also putting out a lot of money if you're not doing it right. Sochi and Russia spent more in the Winter Olympics than the last 7 Winter Olympics combined. And they don't really have money for that. And then they build these buildings that aren't used yet, or these stadiums and arenas. You're supposed to build legacy items that can be used. London did a fairly good job. They built a new rugby stadium and had 2 tenants, meaning 2 rugby teams that have agreed to long-term contracts there. So that's going to pay for itself. The Olympics coming up, I don't know if you're aware, but they did something different at the Olympic Committee that's going to be announced. 2 next summer winters in a row. So we're going to have the Tokyo events, and then they announce the next 4 years, 2024, 2028, are going to be in Paris, and then here in Los Angeles. And Los Angeles probably won't cost them as much money because they're spending $3 billion now for that new football stadium and surrounding areas. So they're going to be able to host a lot of Olympic stuff. So they don't have to add a lot more money. So that's the story. I wish I had more time for you, but if you wanted to ask a question or 2, I'm happy to answer it. There's a lot more here, but I hope we have a little understanding of history, development, politics.